Next on Unsolved Mysteries. A man on the run ends up dead in a deserted parking lot in Tennessee. Who was he running from and why?
This is a holdup. Just stay cool.
A cunning bank robber tells police which bank he's going to hit next and then robs one in a different town. A hidden treasure worth millions is stolen by Ferdinand Marcus. Where is it now? And a moonlight cruise on a lake ends in a horrifying hit-and-run collision. The driver of the boat has gotten away scot-free. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries. Join us. Knoxville, Tennessee.
Bobby, what's going on?
Strangers find a dead man beaten and half naked in a parking lot on a gray July morning. Scattered around the body are a mix of German, Canadian, and U.S. currency, totaling about $4,000. The contents of his wallet identify him as 31-year-old Blair Adams of Surrey, British Columbia.
Every aspect of this case is mysterious. There's no logical explanation for anything he did. We can't say for a fact that this is why he did that, because there's no explanation for it.
We cannot come up with a motive for this man to be dead. We can't come up for a reasoning for him to be here. We can't come up for a reason for him to leave Canada. Nobody knew he was going to take this trip. Nobody. This is an actual whodunit.
No one knows why Blair left his home in British Columbia or how he ended up over 2,000 miles away in Knoxville, Tennessee. His murder is one of the stranger cases we've ever come across. Was Blair running away from a killer, or was Blair just running away from himself? Before his mysterious death, Blair Adams was a foreman with a construction company in Surrey, British Columbia. Those who knew him say Blair liked his work, and he did it well.
Blair did seem to have a normal life. He had many friends. He had a job. He traveled on occasion. He had a history of several different girlfriends. Was well-liked by virtually everyone that we've had contact with.
But then something changed. Blair started having wild mood swings.
I asked him numerous times what was wrong, and he said, "I don't think I should tell you about it." And to this day, I don't know what it is.
On Friday, July 5th, Blair withdrew all his savings. He emptied his safety deposit box. More than $6,000 in cash and thousands in jewelry, gold, and platinum. On Sunday, Blair tried to enter the United States two different times.
Where are you going?
Seattle.
Can you step out of the car? I want to see some ID.
But he was refused entry because he was a young, single guy carrying a lot of cash, the profile of a drug trafficker.
Just get back in the car and turn your vehicle around.
The next day, Blair showed up at his job, but he wasn't there to work.
I need to quit my job.
Why?
Need some time. Can I get my check?
That afternoon, he spent $1,600 on a round-trip airline ticket to Frankfurt, Germany. Just hours after buying the ticket, Blair showed up at a friend's home in a panic.
Blair.
I need you to take me to the border.
Take you to the border? It's the middle of the night. I can't leave my kids.
Kate, somebody's trying to kill me.
Blair seemed terrified, but his friend just couldn't help him out.
Okay, forget about it. Sorry to bother you.
Thanks anyway.
On Tuesday, instead of leaving for Germany, he turned in his tickets, rented a car, and headed back to the border. This time, Blair managed to slip through. He ended up in Seattle, where he dropped his rental car at the airport and bought a one-way ticket to Washington, D.C.
He paid about $770 for a one-way ticket when he could have purchased a round-trip ticket for approximately $350 or $400. So it would have been half the price for a round-trip ticket as he paid for a one-way ticket. It just seemed very unusual.
Blair arrived in D.C. early Wednesday morning and headed to Knoxville, more than 500 miles southwest.
His travel was unlogical in itself. I mean, why go to D.C. to turn around to come back to Knoxville? He had no reason to be in East Tennessee. He had no reason to be in Knoxville. Everything we can find out, he knows no one in East Tennessee or the eastern United States.
Hi,
can you help me? I can't get my car started.
What's the problem?
Blair was first seen in Knoxville around 5:30 that afternoon.
Oh, this can't be your key.
Yeah, that's my key.
Well, this is a Nissan key.
Yeah?
Well, this is a Toyota.
So?
Well, it won't start it.
Well, that's the key I've been using.
You have another key?
No.
So the mechanic says, okay, empty out your pockets and let's look for it. He empties out all his pockets. There is no key to the Toyota.
Blair couldn't get a new key from the rental car company until the next morning. He was stranded in Knoxville. A mechanic drove him to a nearby hotel.
Best way to describe him would be paranoid, nervous, agitated, expecting someone to come in on him even though there wasn't anybody there. I don't know who he was looking for, but he was waiting for somebody to walk in for him.
Maybe Blair was being followed, or maybe he only thought so. The hotel's security camera shows that in the space of an hour, Blair went in and out of the lobby five times before finally paying for a room.
We can only assume that something was wrong with his thought process. He wasn't acting rationally.
After checking in, he walked out the front door. It was 7:37 p.m., the last time Blair Adams was known to be alive. 12 hours later, Blair's body was found in a parking lot about a half mile from his hotel. He was naked from the waist down. Blair's death was as strange as the last few days of his life.
His pants were removed in a way not like someone would take their own pants off, but in a way that someone else would remove your pants from you. His socks were turned inside out, his shoes were off, and his shirt was ripped open.
$4,000 in American, Canadian, and German currency was scattered around Blair's body. A small pack held another $2,000 worth of gold and jewelry. And strangely, the key to Blair's Toyota was laying about 10 feet from his body.
We started looking at the angle of maybe a drug deal gone bad. That didn't pan out. Robbery was immediately first thought of. You throw it away because all the money's still there. We tried to find anything in his background that would have led us to believe that he frequented with prostitutes or that he even had any homosexual experiences. Anything to explain how he was found the way he was found. We found nothing.
The autopsy stated that Blair sustained many cuts and abrasions. This would indicate that he was trying to defend himself from attack. Blair was ultimately killed by a violent blow that ruptured his stomach.
Kate, somebody's trying to kill me.
Although Blair believed that his life was in danger, authorities have another theory. They think that the threat was imaginary and Blair's journey was an escape from his own delusions. Either way, Blair Adams wound up dead, just as he had feared.
I want Blair back. I want him well and healthy. I want him to knock on the front door and come in. But obviously, that's not going to happen. I don't know. You know, Blair is dead. And it would be nice to have some understanding of why he died.
If you have any information about the murder of Blair Adams, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, thanks to a viewer's tip, police close in on a notorious bank robber. And later, a legendary treasure is stolen by a ruthless dictator. It's not surprising that the suspect in our next story vowed never to be taken alive. In the last 35 years, he's only been out of prison for 18 months. When he wasn't doing hard time, he was robbing banks, at least 12 of them, maybe more. His name is Thomas Dixon.
The robbery. Y'all put your hands where I can see them.
This is a holdup. Just stay cool. Nobody's gonna get hurt
in the back. Move it along, move it!
Dixon, what we would call a takeover robbery. They control everything inside the bank, which means when he came into a bank, usually he or his partner would hold somebody at bay with a weapon, make announcements.
Just keep moving! Open. Move it!
Drop the key!
Don't mess with me! Don't mess with me!
The money! Let's get the money!
After a string of 7 robberies, Thomas Dixon went underground. He hit out with his girlfriend in a remote cabin in North Carolina. Federal agents moved in.
We were able to gather enough information about Dixon to know that he had certain patterns that might play in our favor in trying to make an apprehension. We knew that he was a jogger. Dixon has always been in excellent shape.
The FBI wasn't taking any chances.
When the SWAT team went in to make the search of the cabin, in addition to his female companion, there were 7 long-barreled guns, 7 handguns of various size and caliber, 25 sticks of dynamite. And we were absolutely shocked at the amount of weaponry he had inside the apartment.
What is this, huh?
He's got a weapon.
Thomas Dixon spent 10 years behind bars. When he was finally paroled, he picked up right where he left off, robbing banks. But now, Dixon worked alone.
Morning. I'll be right with you.
That's all right. This is a holdup. I got a police scanner, so don't do anything funny. Just be cool and put the money in the bag.
He doesn't come in as a flashy guy. He comes in prepared. He's methodical. He thinks about things before he does them.
In one summer, Dixon pulled off 5 robberies in a 7-week period.
Have you FBI ever heard of Thomas Dixon?
No, should we?
The man is one badass bank robber. Tomorrow he's gonna rob a bank in North Carolina.
Dixon began to warn the FBI about his next bank jobs, but he wasn't always telling the truth. In one call, Dixon said that he was gonna rob a bank in Matthews, North Carolina.
Who's that in the back?
That's the manager.
But he's no dummy. Dixon turned up in Columbia, South Carolina.
Y'all have a nice day. You can turn on that alarm now if you like. Excuse me.
Effingham, South Carolina.
Dispatch to Unit 4. Dispatch to Unit 4. 8 miles south, Route 15. Investigate abandoned vehicle.
About a month after the Columbia job, a deputy in Florence County, South Carolina, recovered the getaway car. Polaroids left in the getaway car showed a huge arsenal of weapons. A rambling message filled 7 pages of a small notebook. It was signed Tom Dixon.
I know the feds are closing in on me, but they need an informant. So need to really watch who I trust. I will not go back to prison under no conditions ever for any length of time.
FBI agents believed that Dixon was becoming more and more unstable. They also believed that Dixon deliberately left the photos, the getaway car, and the message in the notebook for them to find.
Now I need a really good score so I can go underground for a few months, get myself back together. I got myself a bulletproof vest. So maybe it'll save my ass long enough to drop a couple of them before I die. P.S. You keep looking and I'll keep working. We'll meet up someday and we'll see if it's you or is it me.
I don't think there's any question that Dixon has become a walking time bomb. Dixon was alerting us to the fact that he is heavily armed and he has every intention of using those arms in a confrontation with law enforcement.
Several weeks later, Dixon struck again, this time in Pennsylvania. He eventually made his way to Clarksville, Tennessee. There, Dixon took a room in this motel. Pam Petit, a resident housekeeper, first became suspicious of Dixon when she cleaned his room.
It's the way he acted. He was weird. He wouldn't ever sit down, didn't want you to make the beds, you know, stuff like that. It's like he was on guard, you know, his luggage. He just was, you know, ready, watching you.
Update. When we aired Thomas Dixon's story, Pam Petit recognized him and contacted both Unsolved Mysteries and the authorities in Tennessee. By sunrise, FBI agents staked out Dixon's hideaway.
We knew he was armed and dangerous, and he had vowed not to be taken alive. With that information, obviously you want to approach the subject with extreme caution. But once we got him subdued, he was very cooperative. All he said is, the way that you guys arrested me was the way you needed to arrest me. And it was a lot better that way than, quote, to throw bullets at each other.
Well, you got me good.
Thomas Dixon pled guilty in federal court to 7 armed bank robberies in 4 states. He will be eligible for release in 2020 when he is 73 years old. Next, a hit-and-run boating accident leaves a young woman fighting for her life. Louisville Lake, Texas, 20 miles north of Dallas. Stephanie Booker and 2 friends, Sabra Scott and Kim Colvin, spent the day swimming and sailing on the lake. It was a typical outing until nightfall. After a break for dinner, the 3 friends decided to take one last cruise beyond the breakwater.
Look at how nice
so
that
pretty.
Is.
That's great.
Guys, it's late. We gotta get back.
Near midnight, the friends headed back to the boat slip.
Kim, it's really dark. Can you help me up front?
They slowed down as they entered the no-wake zone, where boaters are required to stay under 5 miles an hour. Then, 100 yards away, a speedboat raced out of the darkness. For a moment, only silence and shock.
What did you just do? Do you know what you just did? You just hit my boat! Oh my God!
I could feel someone tugging on the back of my shirt, and it was Stephanie, and I could see that she was in serious condition. I tried to speak, and no words would come out. It was as if my mouth felt sewn shut. And so I had to brace myself with my hands to push my body up. And then I felt this terrible weight hanging off of my face, as if dough was hanging off of my face. And I reached up and realized that my face was in my hand.
The speedboat's propeller had slashed across Stephanie's face, literally, slicing it from the bone.
Her lips were detached from her face. I couldn't see any gums or teeth. There was skin hanging down from her eye, so I was seeing her exposed face, and I could tell she was having a hard time breathing.
Mom, I'm gonna kill you!
Guys, we need some help! Please, guys!
On the other boat, a young woman appeared at the driver's side. They stared. Neither said a word.
Guys, we need your help! Please, guys!
He stood there as if contemplating the pros and the cons. I'm sure he thought he already killed someone.
I remember one of the individuals making the other person to kind of like be silent, don't say anything. So it was total silence with me yelling and screaming at him. They made no motions to say one word or make any actions to come to help us.
Come help us! We need help! We need help!
The driver did nothing. He simply gunned his engine and took off.
They're leaving! Get back to the dock! We need some help! She's okay!
Kim turned her attention back to Stephanie. Sabra got the boat started and headed for shore.
Back to the dock!
I'm thinking to myself that Stephanie is going to quit breathing any minute now. I can't give her mouth to mouth because I'm afraid if I put any pressure, it'll cave in any facial structure she has. And also, I didn't think there was an airway big enough to get any air in her. Looking at Kim not being able to breathe very well, I felt a very conscious decision to either live or die. And so at that moment, instead of freaking out, looking at Kim's face, I decided to just remain calm. And it was as if a power overcame me and gave me this incredible strength to take control of my life.
Stephanie was rushed to surgery, and police started looking for the driver of the other boat or anyone who might have seen him.
Right after the accident, we have two witnesses that were there. They heard the screaming, they heard the noise coming from the accident. And then about 15 or 20 seconds after that, they saw a boat fitting this description just come hauling butt.
5 minutes later, another eyewitness saw two people load the same boat onto a trailer towed by a white 4x4 pickup truck. And then it took off into the night. The community was outraged. Local businesses raised reward money. Stephanie suffered through her own private ordeal. It took 12 reconstructive surgeries to rebuild her internal facial structure.
I walk by a mirror after I've had one of my many surgeries and look at myself and just wonder, why did someone do this? Why did they not come forward? Why don't they care?
We need help! We need help! She's hurt!
At least one person did seem to care. Police have heard from the same anonymous caller 3 times.
He stated emphatically that he knew who it was, that he was going to talk to the person and try to get them to turn themselves in. From just the tone of his voice and the way he was talking, we think that he does know who it is, and we would like for him to at least contact us.
It frightens me that these people are still out there. They've proven that they place absolutely no value whatsoever on human life. That was shown the night of our accident when they chose to leave us there to die. My feelings towards the people in the other boat was I felt very sorry for them. It had to be devastating to cause an accident like this. However, they do need to do the right thing and come forward so that I can move on and try to get back as close to normal as possible.
The suspects were driving a Miami Vice-style speedboat with a single-engine Mercury Cruiser outdrive, similar to these. It's 25 to 30 feet long and painted white with teal-green markings. The fiberglass shell was probably damaged on the starboard side about 5 feet from the stern. The driver of the speedboat was a stocky, clean-shaven white male with light hair. His companion, an athletic-looking woman with very long, dark hair. They drove a white 4x4 pickup. If you have any information regarding this case, please contact us at unsolved.com. Next, a man discovers a fortune in hidden treasure, but it's stolen a few months later by Ferdinand Marcos. From 1965 to 1986, Ferdinand Marcos ruled the Philippines. First, he was elected, and then he was a dictator. By the time he was deposed, his personal wealth was estimated at $10 billion. Much of it was stolen from his own people. Few dared to challenge Marcos, but in 1971, a man named Roger Rojas defied Marcos and went public with a daring accusation. He accused the dictator's soldiers of stealing a rare solid gold Buddha worth millions. Roger Rojas and his family lived 200 miles north of Manila on the Philippine island of Luzon. On weekends, Roger spent his time treasure hunting. One of Roger's fellow treasure hunters was Albert Fujigami. Albert had been shown a treasure map by his father, who was an officer in the Japanese Army during World War II. The map pinpointed the location of a secret tunnel system where the Japanese had left behind a fortune in gold bars.
We were friends for a long time before he told me that he knew of a hidden treasure. He revealed to me what he knew about the tunnels.
Roger and Albert hired a crew to excavate. In a few weeks, the crew broke through into some tunnels. The tunnel system was elaborate, complete with railroad tracks. An explosion blocked all access to the main underground passageway, so they dug a narrow tunnel around the rocks.
To my surprise, I found several Japanese skeletons. There must have been more than 10.
It looked like Japanese soldiers had been trapped underground and that their own retreating army set off the explosions to hide the tunnel. The explorers were stunned. Sitting in the cavity was a large statue of a Buddha. It was made of solid gold. The golden Buddha weighed hundreds of pounds. And while the crew attempted to move it, Roger and Albert went further into the tunnel and made another incredible discovery. Just as the map had predicted, there were boxes and boxes of solid gold bars. Rojas and Fujigami decided to dynamite the tunnel to hide the treasure. They planned to sell the Buddha to buy trucks and equipment so they can come back and get the gold out of the tunnel. Roger took the Buddha home. A potential buyer confirmed the Buddha was solid gold. Roger noticed that the buyer paid particular attention to the Buddha's neck.
My brother and I had a suspicion that there was an opening inside the Buddha. We got a piece of wood and we hit the Buddha several times with this piece of wood.
Roger says there were handfuls of diamonds inside a secret compartment. He hid them in a closet. That night, Roger's brother took these pictures. Roger thought that that they might protect him. He was wrong. News of his discovery had already spread all the way to the president's palace in Manila. Although the Philippines was a democracy, Ferdinand Marcos, along with his wife Imelda, ruled like a king with an iron hand and brute force. Two months after Roger brought the Buddah home, Marcos's elite palace guard invaded the house. Out of nowhere, the potential buyer appeared.
Musta, Mr. Rojas?
Roger had been double-crossed.
They took everything, even the piggy banks of my children. Whatever my wife inherited, all her jewelry, all the diamonds in the closet, they took all of it. If we had fought back, they would just have killed us.
The next day, Roger and his brothers reported the incident to the local police. Then they went to visit Judge Pio Marcos, a family friend.
I told him, Judge, why did you let them confiscate my treasure? We're friends. He said, Roger, there is nothing that I can do. I said, why? He said, because the prince asked for it. I said, who's the prince? And he said, the prince, President Marcos.
Pero Judge, sinuha lahat ang mga
gamit mo. Roger, mali ang ginawa mo na tinawagan mo ang pulis sapagkat ngayon, malalaman ng mga tao na ang Pangulo ay kasabwat sa kasong ito. Malaking pagkakamali. At umalis na kayo rito sa Baguio. Delikado ka. Pinirma na ang death warrant mo. Bahala ka na, Roger.
Roger and his family fled to an isolated jungle village to hide from Marcos. While Roger remained secluded, Filipino reporters had already gotten a hold of the story. Marcos allowed the press to view the Buddha, but his political opponents felt that he had substituted a fake. They wanted to embarrass Marcos, so they tracked down Roger and they convinced him to return to Manila to identify the Buddha.
Ginong Rojas, ang budang ito ba'y kapareho sa natuklasan mo?
Hindi. Hindi yan ang aking Buddha.
Pinipilit mo ba rin ba ng Pangulo ang siyang nagnakaw ng natuklasan mong kayamanan?
Yun ang palagay ko.
Kapanik ka ba ng oposisyon?
Hindi naman ako mahilig sa politika eh.
Salamat, Roger. Maraming salamat po sa inyo lahat. Maraming salamat po.
Marcos was outraged. Once again, Roger went into hiding. But 2 weeks later, he was tracked down by the palace guard.
3 men approached me and pointed their guns at me. They knew me. They told me, Roger, come with us in the car. We will bring you to Manila. I could not escape. I knew they were soldiers. They had guns.
I need to speak to the boss.
They called the palace and they were speaking English. I knew that it was Marcos that they were talking to because they addressed him as Mr. President. Marcos must have asked them, are you sure it is Roger Rojas that you captured? And they said, yes, we're sure.
The soldiers locked Roger in a hotel. They tortured him until he signed a paper stating that he was paid off to lie about the Buddha. The soldiers also wanted Roger to tell them where the gold was hidden. He was tortured daily for several weeks. The torture permanently damaged the nerves around Roger's left eye.
I made a promise to Mr. Fujigami. I told him, even if they try to kill me, I will not tell them where the tunnel is.
Eventually, Roger was allowed to see his family.
My wife was crying. She was surprised. She said, what is happening to you? You know they might kill you. And I said, just pray. And then the soldiers took me again.
Roger was taken back to the same hotel where he had been tortured.
I knew they were going to kill me. But you know, I'm a locksmith. I know how to open locks. So I went to the restroom. There was a small window with a small lock.
Roger Rojas went into hiding and never saw the Golden Buddha again. At least two witnesses claim to have seen the Buddha in one of Marcos's summer palaces. Ferdinand Marcos died in 1989, but rumors persist that his family still has the Golden Buddha.
Of course, it's very painful. I worked very hard for it. I spent so much time, about 7 months, that we really labored hard. And then in 1 hour, they take it all away. It's very, very painful.
Update. Roger Rojas filed a civil suit to recover the Buddha. On the day he was set to testify, Rojas collapsed and died. Some reports blame a heart attack, but others allege foul play. The Rojas family has continued legal action against the Marcos estate. The case has been tied up in the court system for more than a decade. Next, a 14-year-old boy survived many brutal years in a concentration camp during World War II. And now, he would like to say thank you to the man who gave him the will to live. Our next story is about one boy's will to survive the horrors of a Nazi concentration camp. It's the story of his chance meeting with an American GI, a meeting that would help save the boy's life. Lodz, Poland. The German invasion brought Poland to its knees in just 3 devastating weeks. Hitler directed his most vicious attack against the Jews of Poland. A young Polish boy, 8-year-old Steve Ross, was separated from his family. For 5 years, he would be a prisoner in 10 different concentration camps. The last one was Dachau in Germany.
It was extremely difficult to survive because there was not enough food. We got a liter soup for lunch and a liter soup for supper. And we got one slice of bread that was divided up from 1 pound of bread for 20 people. At the best time, we fell apart by working 12 to 14 hours a day. Cleanliness, we never were able to wash up. I didn't see any hot water for 5 years. There wasn't such a thing as hot water. There was nothing in there to sleep on except the boards. You slept on the boards, no blankets. You covered yourself with what you had, and with lack of food, you couldn't survive much longer. So people kept dying constantly. As long as you survive today, from one day to the next, that's all you were worrying about. Do I have another day to live? We all pray to God all the time.
In April of 1945, Allied troops finally liberated the concentration camps. An American GI took this picture of the cheering inmates at Dachau. One of them was Steve Ross, who was then 14. Steve's older brother had also ended up at Dachau. The two boys found out later that their mother, father, and 6 brothers and sisters all died in other camps.
2 days after we were liberated, we were released from the camp and we were asked to go towards hospitalizations. We walked by a unit that was tanks, and there was a soldier sitting on the tank.
Hey, kid.
He jumped off the tank and he gave me the can that he was eating from. I closed it up, and I gave it to my brother, and I fell down on my knees, and I held on to his legs, and I kissed his boots for giving me the food.
Hey, listen, everything's gonna be all right.
He was a good man. He put his hand around on me, and he wasn't scared he's gonna get my lice or my diseases or my sicknesses.
Hey, throw me some rations, will you?
He knew how to put his arm around me at that time in my life, when nobody ever done that before.
Take this. You keep it. Hold it with you, okay?
That soldier gave me a handkerchief. I did not know till later on that this was a flag, the flag of freedom.
Steve carried that flag with him when he came to the United States in 1948. Steve married, had a son and a daughter. His brother, the only other surviving family member, lived close by. Steve became a licensed psychologist, counseling disadvantaged teenagers in Boston. He wanted to help other children the way the unknown GI helped him.
Safe now.
If I could ever find this soldier, I would say to him that he is part of my life. I want him to know that what he has done for me, that I emulated and that I love people because of him.
Steve thinks the American soldier belonged to the 191st Army Tank Battalion. It was part of the 20th Armored Division. He was traveling from Dachau towards Munich around the 1st of May in 1945. If you think you know who that soldier was, or if you have any information on any of our other stories, please contact us at unsolved.com.